Dave Ward and Friends is proud to be supported by Sonic Automotive. My family has driven a Sonic Automotive car for 12 years, and I know they're the best in the business. Whether it's purchasing a new or pre-owned car or servicing your current vehicle, let Sonic Automotive be your trusted car guides. Start looking for your new car at soniccars.com. Well, Houston, we've been through a lot together. We started in radio 60 years ago. It was such a great gig, my father cautioned me against going into this thing called television, but we did it, and we had a pretty good run. We even went from black and white to color TV, then to high definition. I keep hearing about streaming and digital, and well, it's a chance to reconnect with my friends and viewers and share stories from our times together throughout these last six decades. What do you say, Houston? Let's do this. Hello, friends. I'm Dave Ward, and welcome to Dave Ward and Friends, a series of casual conversations with some of the people that I met during my 60 years of radio and television news broadcasting in Houston. Many of them you know, some you may not. I think you're going to know this guy. I want to introduce to you Mr. Steve Tyrell, recording artist, a musician extraordinaire. Steve, how are things out there in Los Angeles?
Well, it's not as good as the all-night show at K-NUZ. but it's pretty good. Things are great. I mean, considering what the world is going through.
Yeah, you know, it is a mess.
I got my vaccination last week. And so I'm lucky about that. I have one more.
Laura and I get our second shots tomorrow, so we're looking forward to that too. A little sore arm, but
you know, you've got to be. You can't take any of that stuff for granted.
That's a fact.
I'm trying to move my camera a little bit because you look so good and I look so old. He brought his lighting crew with him.
Oh, let's go back to the beginning. I gotta tell people how we met. When I was at K-NUZ Radio, oh my goodness, this has been almost 60 years ago.
Right, I was only three years old at the time.
Yeah, right, exactly, yeah.
I was child the first prodigy. Three-year-old promotion man.
Right. Well, anyway, some of the disc jockeys there at K-NUZ, they've been playing sock hops. At various high schools, junior high schools and high schools around the area. They were there as the MC or disc jockey, but they noticed that the bands that played these sock hops were making a lot more money than they were. So the decision was made by the guys there at K-NUZ, let's form our own band. We'll call it the K-NUZ Seven Southern Gentlemen or something like that.
Right.
Well, if I remember right, Arch Yancey tried to play the bass. Joe Ford tried to play guitar. I think Paul Williams tried to play the drums, and they got me to get my trumpet, to play my trumpet. And we got together and tried to make music, and
Chuck Adams was in too, right?
That's right, Chuck Baby Adams. He was
Chuck
in there.
Baby Adams. Now, what was Chuck doing? I don't remember what he did. Maybe he just was the MC or something. I don't remember what Chuck Adams did.
He was a disc jockey.
Oh no, I'm talking about stage. In the band.
I don't remember either. I don't remember what he tried to play, but I do remember that we got together to try to make music. And after a couple of minutes, I had to stop, and I just had to tell them, guys, we sound like hammered crap.
If we hire ourselves out to play anywhere, they're going to throw Rotten Tomatoes at us. And somebody, it might have been Joe Ford or Arch, I'm not sure, said, well, I've got a this friend of mine, Steve Tyrell, he's got a band. Maybe he could join us and become part of the group and help us out. Sounded good to me. Well, then you came along with a couple of your players, and I don't remember who they were or what instruments.
They were from CL and the Pictures. They were from CL and the Pictures. Oh. That was the band that we were in, and we had some records that were just coming out. And I think Paul Berlin helped us, too. I think he might have had something to do with that suggestion.
I'm sure he did.
A good old Memphis boy.
I don't think Berlin tried to play any instrument.
No, he didn't. But I think he might have suggested that I come into the band, I think.
It probably was him.
He took credit for it. Whoever designed our I have a picture of us in our uniform somewhere.
Oh, yeah.
You remember? We did a reboot, like, I don't know, years later, and out at a big concert. Remember?
Yeah, I do. Yes, I do. I really do.
Oh, I should have had that photo with us.
I walked out there on that blue stage. Suit. I got to show you.
Blue sequin suit. I remember it. There it is. There it is. There it is.
Did we look silly or what?
No, you look good, man.
Still
Elvis. Elvis stole everything he knows from you.
Yeah, right.
That still looks good on you, man. You can wear that on New Year's Eve. And it still fits you, which is amazing.
Well, kind of. But I remember the tailor who custom made these things for us was over in Southeast Houston. I don't remember his name, but I remember in the tab, I've got my initials in mine. The label, which some way or other got torn out of mine, had his name, Taylor, and it had Houston, Texas. And he spelled Houston, H-O-U-S-T-I-N.
Really? Houston. Really?
Yeah.
He wasn't Houston. Rex the Taylor, was he, by any chance?
You know, I don't remember. I don't remember.
It sounds familiar to me. Like that.
It could have been.
We knew a Rex the Taylor. Well, we had so much fun, Dave, and we've been having it, ever since.
You've
been my friend for all these years, and you are what's called a treasured friend.
Well, you are an American standard. and
I've been called worse.
I only won one Emmy in my entire television career, and it was for the 30-minute documentary program that we did on you and your home and growing up here in Houston, and
I was very proud of that. I'm still very proud of that. Every once in a while, I'll pop it out and watch it. Can they get it online there?
I don't know. You got me.
You should be able to.
Well, I remember I wanted to call it Steve Tyrell, the Accidental Singer.
Yeah.
But the station said no. Steve Tyrell, an American Standard, I think is what they had us call it.
I thought, but you referred to me as the, because it really was true. I mean, I wasn't wanting to make a career in standards. You know, I was producing records. I think at that time I had produced Linda Ronstadt and Aaron Neville's record was about when we did that, which was a big hit. And worked as a record producer, and I was doing music for films and stuff.
Yes, I know. I remember seeing your studio.
Yeah, I know. That's we took a whole trip around L.A. and we checked out the Little League that we did. Remember? I was very proud that I was the Little League coach, and we had Eddie Van Halen's kid playing with us.
Yep.
You know,
You produced Elvis Presley's record, Suspicious Minds, if I remember right.
Well, Chip Smallman actually got credited as a producer, but there was a fellow in Houston that I have believed in very much, always. His name was Mark James, and I was his manager, and trying to get something going for him. And I started working in Memphis. I left Houston and I started working with Memphis, and Memphis started getting very hot. And I was working with BJ Thomas back in mostly all his records. And so I told BJ, let's go to Memphis and record. And they got a great studio going on down there. And I brought Mark with me, Mark James, this songwriter that I thought was so great. And almost right off the bat, it was just a good, you know, combination of talented people. Mark wrote he ended up writing Hooked on a Feeling, but he wrote The Eyes of a New York Woman, which we recorded with BJ, and that was a big hit. Then he wrote Hooked on a Feeling. And then he wrote a song that with me that Elvis did, and BJ did it first. And we started to get friendly with Elvis. He liked what we were doing, and he would invite us to Graceland. And that was kind of the thing. I mean, this was Elvis, man, you know. And he really liked BJ's records and what they were doing down there. And he liked the way Mark James wrote, and he ended up recording Suspicious Minds on this last, when he went to Memphis. And that became his biggest hit ever in his whole career.
Wow.
Presley records, Suspicious Minds is the biggest one. Sold the most records of anything he ever did.
The only time I ever saw Elvis Presley was we were living in Cisco, Texas, out near Abilene. This is back in the 50s, late 50s. And mid-50s, and Elvis Presley was coming to play in Abilene. Well, me and my buddy in Cisco was a guy named Dash Crofts, who was half of Seals and Crofts. So he and I took a couple of dates, and we drove to Abilene and went to see Elvis Presley in this concert that night. And when he came out on stage and started his gyrating, all the girls, including our date, started screaming. And Dash and I, we couldn't really understand what all the fuss was about, but it was Elvis.
He had something, man, electric. But you know what? I got to say, I got to know him. And I told you, I went to Graceland. I went to the last time I got invited to his New Year's Eve party, which wasn't at Graceland. It was at a club in Memphis called, I think, Thunderbird or something like that. And Elvis, it was his party. And Ronnie Millsap was the house band, which was another guy that I kind of discovered and turned Elvis on to, was Ronnie Millsap. So Ronnie was playing with his band. And Elvis came in, and I'll never forget. I thought to myself, this is the best looking man I've ever seen in my life. You know, I mean, this guy was like stunning, man. You know, I was like right up next to him. And I got up and sang with Ronnie's band, Stand By Me, you know, when the night has come and the land is dark. And the moon is the only light we'll see. And it went over really well. Everybody at the party was rocking along. And Elvis never set in. Like, he had rules that, like, he wouldn't get up and sing with a band, you know. He'd sing with his own band, but not, he just never did that. And he got up and he got like, almost walked up to the stage. And I thought he was going to jump up there and start singing at the party with me, you know. But then he didn't.
At Sonic Automotive, we went from happy guests to happy owners. I felt right at home during the whole process, if my home only had a bigger garage for all those cars. Sonic Automotive has 13 stores in the Houston area, providing you 10 vehicle brands for new sales and services. Visit soniccars.com to find your new car. Dave Ward and Friends is proud to be supported by Sonic Automotive. Let Sonic Automotive be your trusted car guys. Visit soniccars.com to find the location near you.
When I was in Tyler Junior College, on a band scholarship playing my trumpet, I picked up a big old standard bass fiddle, a big bass, and taught myself how to play the thing. And
that's hard to do, man, because it doesn't have any frets.
No, it doesn't. You gotta
know where the note is.
No, exactly. Well, I worked on that thing so much I rubbed the horrible blisters on my fingers on my right hand, but I got to where I could play it pretty good. And there were two other guys. One played a guitar, or I think both of them played guitars, and I'm playing the bass. And we got up and performed in front of Tyler Junior College student body one time at an assembly. And we sang Tom Dooley, Hang Down Your Head, Tom Dooley.
Hang
poor
down,
boy, you're yeah. bound to die.
That's right.
And when it came to my part to go, boy, or something like that, they laughed. The whole student body just erupted. And I thought, what did I do that was so damn funny? But that was, that's so
I'm trying to
ago.
Think what part of the song it was that would have made them laugh. Oh, yeah. Boy, you're bound to die.
Yeah. Know. Oh, boy.
I don't know. But that was another thing. That was a big hit song.
Yeah, tell me, it was a huge song. Who did it? Kingston Trio?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
Tell me another thing, if you don't mind me asking. How did you get the name Tyrell? I mean, your real last name is Blair.
I was singing in this band. This was all the way back at the beginning when I was singing with CL in the Pictures. Actually, Charlie Broyles was the guitar player, and we got a job at Oak Park in Kema, and it became kind of a really cool place to go. You know, I was only like 16; the rest of the band was in their 20s, and but it was, man, it was a swinging place. And so I would ride out there with Charlie in his pink Cadillac. And we'd be listening to the radio, and I'd be singing along with the radio. And he said, man, you ever think about singing yourself? And this when I was like 16 or 17 years old. He said, you've got a good voice. You know, he said, why don't I teach you a couple of songs on the guitar? And then you get up with us one night, I'll call you up and you can sing with our band. And that's how I became a singer. So I started doing it and people started liking it. And the guy that owned the club started giving me a little money if I'd come and sit in and sing with the band, CL in the Pictures. And then we started playing all around Houston. We played at Jimmy Minutis club, you know, and I got a record contract from the same people that CL in the Pictures had a record deal with. And so I went to Beaumont, Texas, and recorded my first song, Payday Someday. And I was driving back, and everybody, my name is Steve Baleo. I'm Italian, the boy. I'm an Italian, the boy. I'm akin to the Carrabbas. and you know, the Mandolas, and all of those we're all. So nobody could ever pronounce my name, Dave. It was because it was B-I-L-A-O is my real name. And nobody ever got Baleo out of that. They called me Billio, Balu, or whatever. So they said, man, you should change your name. So I'd already made my record, and we're driving back from Beaumont, and there's a town there called Terrell Park, Texas. You heard of it?
I've seen it, yeah.
Terrell Park, Texas. It's right out of Beaumont. It's where Jamie Foxx is from.
I didn't know that.
And everything I saw, I was changing my last name. You know, I'd see a Folgers coffee ad, and I go, Steve Folgers. No, that's not it. And then I saw this Terrell Park, which I thought was Tyrell. So I said, Steve Tyrell. And everybody in the car driving said, yeah, that's cool. And that's the origin of my name. They put it on my first record, and it stuck, you know.
Yeah. Well, tell us how you got to where you were singing on records and albums and in the movies. and how that came to be. It was in the movie, the remake of, Father of the Bride.
Well, that kind of did it for me, but that, I went back to, I started making records, and that Payday Someday was sort of a hit in Houston and New Orleans and Dallas and a few local. And then I did a couple of more records, but I really wasn't interested in being a singer, you know? I thought, and then I met BJ Thomas and I started working with him, and I thought, man, this guy could really sing, you know? And so I started producing his records or finding his songs for him and promoting them. And BJ got to be very, very, you know, he sold a lot of records, millions. So I lost my interest in being an artist myself. I was more interested in working with BJ, and then I met Burt Bacharach and Dionne Warwick. And so I was like, I wanted to be the guy behind the scenes. And it started leading, actually Dionne Warwick and BJ kind of led me into the movie business, because BJ got the job in Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid to sing Raindrops.
Yeah.
And I was behind the scene in that. So I started getting jobs in movies. And every once in a while, Dave, I would do a demo or something that for the director and say, why don't you use this song? And I'd sing it for him. And more than once, quite a few times, the director said, well, why don't you just do it in the movie? You know, and I said, well, I wasn't thinking about that, but I sang in several films before Father of the Bride, but always in that role. Like I'd sing a song over the opening credits or something, you know, and instead of they'd rather pay me, you know, $5 than Tony Bennett $500, you know, or $5,000. So I would get jobs like that where they need a song coming out of a jukebox and I'd be the guy singing. And then that went all the way to, so I started working in movies, and then when Father of the Bride came out, I made a demo of The Way You Look Tonight, and I sang it, played it for the director and Steve Martin and everybody as a demo, you know, like, why don't you use this song? And people said, well, why don't you sing it? I said, well, let me check with my agent. You know, and I was glad to do it. So I did it, and that movie became a very big hit. And my singing in those Father of the Bride movies, you know, kind of exploded all over the world. People love those movies, and I'm the voice of those movies.
Yeah, they had to reshoot the scene where the band is playing to put you and your group in there on camera.
Yeah.
Didn't they? That's what I thought.
Yeah, no, well, they I don't know if they had shot it before, but they did shoot it with me and the band, me and my band. We're in the movie. First, yeah. I sang it as a demo, and then I ended up being in the movie, and the rest is history. Then I got a record contract, and from Atlantic Records, the same company that discovered Ray Charles and Aretha Franklin and Otis Redding and all these people. They said, man, you should make your own album. So I did, and it sold about, I don't know, 400,000 copies or something. And the next thing you know, I was a recording artist. I've made, the irony of the whole thing is I've made, this is my, what, Isaac, 13th album?
13th album.
I've made 12 albums. They've all gone into, been the top five sellers of their time when they came out. And like I said, the guy who gave me, the company that gave me my start had Ray Charles. And now my next album is coming out and I'm just finishing up is a salute to the great Ray Charles. So my next album is going to be a Ray Charles album.
I can't wait to hear it.
Oh, man,
I hear you quite often on my satellite radio in my car on the Sinatra channel.
Yes. Well, hey, they've been so great to me. They became big fans, Nancy and Tina and Frankie and Mrs. Sinatra, Frank's original. Both, I knew both of the Sinatra wives, you know, Barbara, and they've supported me the whole time. They still do. And that was kind of, I've been lucky enough to get a few little things like that that give you encouragement, you know?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I thought, well, hell, if the Sinatra's like what I'm doing, then maybe I'll keep doing it.
I remember when I was out there in Los Angeles at your recording studio, and Frank Sinatra Jr. was there. Yeah. And I asked him what he thought about you and your music, and he said, I can do it in one word, class.
Wow. That was
nice. I'll never forget that.
He used to call me a Texas blues singer. You know, he said, man, if you, because, you know, my take on the standards is a little rougher than most of the guys that sing those beautiful, you know, standards like Tony and Frank. And,
yeah.
And so Frankie used to say, yeah, well, Steve's a Texas blues singer. That's why his versions. He was a great guy, man. I miss him. He was a big influence in me, and he helped me tremendously.
I remember during the taping and filming for the 30-minute special I did on you.
We're driving to put down. That online, man. We have to put that online and let people see it. It's great. I love it.
We were driving down Shepherd, and we got near Richmond Avenue, and you said, oh, pull over here, stop. And we stopped at the corner of Shepherd and Richmond, and you got out to peer through the window of a building there that you said at one time was a club. It was something
Swing
else.
Swinging Shepherd. The Swinging Shepherd.
Is that
Shepherd.
What it was?
It was called the Swinging Shepherd. I played there for years. I have a fond memory of it. The Swinging Shepherd. There used to be good clubs in Houston, you know, where you could go hear good music and people would dance. And that was one of them. Jimmy Menudo's was one. Oak Park was another one. And that Swinging Shepherd was swinging, man.
I did an interview segment with Mickey Gilley.
Mm-hmm. He would know all those places.
3 or 4 months ago. He's still kicking. He's still doing good.
Yeah, yeah.
He really is. Well,
he made that whole nightclub world that he was in, Gilly's, world famous.
You know. Yeah, he really did.
They made a movie about it. Mickey was always, I didn't know Mickey very well, but we always liked each other, you know.
Yeah, right.
He was Jerry Lee Lewis's or is his nephew or something.
Right? Right. Yeah. Or cousin or something like that. Yeah. Well, and you mentioned Jimmy Menudo's club. What were some of the others around town that you played?
Well, there was a place called Van's Ballroom. That was sort of like, that came after. Jimmy Menudo's was the, at least for my time period when I was there, was the place. It was an old theater. You know, do you remember it, Dave? Did you ever go there?
I vaguely remember it.
It was on Wayside and Telephone Road.
Yeah.
And it was an old theater. I think it was called the Wayside Theater. And Jimmy bought it, and it was just, I'll send you a picture of it. He put a big saxophone player on the marquee. You know, I have a picture. One of my favorite pictures of my life in my career was the marquee at Jimmy Menudo's. It says, and I'll send it to you. It says, tonight, CL in the pictures, with Steve Tyrell. And then it says, next week, Bobby Blue Bland. I thought, my God, I'm playing the same place Bobby Blue Bland plays. That's good enough for me.
There you go.
Send that to Dave, will you?
Yeah, you're talking about the photo.
On the marquee. You'll see the Jimmy Menudo's marquee with this guy on the top, you know, playing the saxophone, like a statue kind of thing.
You said you've kind of been housebound for about a year.
A year.
I'm so tired of wearing these masks. but I think we're stuck with them probably for another year.
Yeah, probably. I'm hoping that by the next fall we'll be, we'll be okay. But
yeah.
You know, we're lucky. We got our vaccines. Some people didn't. Some people didn't make it. I had lots of friends that, didn't make it. Guys that you know too.
I know.
That are still no longer with us.
So your next album,
serious thing.
Yeah, it is. You said your next album you're coming out with is a tribute to Ray Charles?
Yeah, it's going to be called Shades of Ray.
Shades of Ray.
That's cool, right?
Yeah.
I'll send it to you. Remember that said David? I don't have it. I have it almost. I have too many songs. I'll send you all of them. I have to cut some of them out, But they're all the songs we grew up with, and I'll send you a CD of it to check.
There was
out.
One old Ray Charles song. I don't know if you included it, but Lonely Avenue.
Yes, I didn't do it on. No, I didn't do it on this. But I know the song very well. I live on a lonely avenue, and it's all because of you. I'm so sad and blue on my lonely avenue. I should have done it. There's so many great ones.
I always thought that was one of his best.
Yeah, you know who did a good version of it? Diana Krall.
I
should have done Lonely Avenue. But see, that's my problem. That's my problem. I did about 18 songs, and I can only use 12 on an album. You'll have to tell me which ones to get rid of.
Well, if you did 18, you've got an album and a half.
I know.
You got a half an album ready to go.
Yeah, but the first, trying to decide what not to put on this first album has been difficult, man, because I like all those songs. I don't think there's anybody, Dave, that's rises, in my opinion, to the level of Ray Charles.
Yeah, he was really one of the greats.
He could do anything. That's what made him so great. Uh-huh. I mean, he could sing standards, blues, jazz, rock music, whatever, at the highest possible level.
Yep. I started in radio as a disc jockey in Tyler when I was like 18 years old. And I loved playing Ray Charles records. I just always did. He was always one of my favorites. Do you have any plans to be in Houston anytime soon?
Well, as soon as I am able to go back to work,
one
of the first spots is going to be playing in Houston. Dave, I love you, man. You are a treasure in my life, and you have been for a long time.
Well, one thing I forgot to bring up. At the Crime Stoppers banquet here a few years ago, you flew down. It was just a total surprise to me.
Yeah. Well, that's such a wonderful thing that you do, man.
That was the night that they announced they were building their new headquarters building, and they were going to name it after me. And I had no idea that you were going to be there. And I was standing up there talking with some people, and I get a tap on my shoulder and turn around, and there you were.
Man, I'll tell you, there's not many people I know, if anybody I know, that I am as connected to in my whole life as I am with you, Dave.
Well, bless your heart. I remember the song you sang that night. Laura wanted you to sing You've Got a Friend in Me.
Did I sing it that night?
Yes, you did. But you had told her earlier you didn't think you could do it because it was written as a duet.
Yeah,
between two guys, but your arranger arranged it, and you got up there on that stage and you sang You Got a Friend in Me. I'll never forget that.
That's Randy Newman's song.
Randy Newman's song.
My friend Dr. John, I loved his version.
Yeah, right.
Once
again, Steve, you're out in L.A. now.
Yeah.
And you don't have any plans to move away from there at all, do you?
You mean out of the city? No.
Yeah.
No, I'm very happy in my little house. I've been sitting in this. I've been in this house for 35 years, And
Laura and I haven't been in this house 35 years, but we've been here, 17, 15, 16 years now. And I don't have any plans to move anywhere out of Houston. This is my home.
Well, I mean, Houston's my home too, but I go to it. Yeah. You know what I mean? I don't have a home there anymore.
Yeah, I understand.
I'd always stay at my sister's house, but so always, Houston's always my, you know,
well,
home. But this home I've been in, I love it. It's a nice little cottage, and I know where the toothpaste is.
There you go.
I know where everything is.
Well, next time you come to Houston, if you need to, you can stay here with Laura and me.
Okay, that sounds like a deal. That sounds like a deal for sure.
All right,
my friend. I love you. I love our friendship that we've had all these years.
I do too.
Take care, my brother.
Thank you very much. And thank you for watching Dave Ward and Friends.
Buckle your seatbelts, friends. You won't believe the VIP perks that Sonic Automotive is offering you. $500 cash toward a new vehicle, $250 cash toward a pre-owned vehicle, 25% off any repair or service, and more. Thank you, Sonic Automotive, for being the official sponsor of the Dave Ward and Friends podcast. To see the VIP perks they're offering my friends, visit SonicCars.com.